Hey robot makers, how you doing? Hope you're having a good day so far. So, do you want to know how to write Micropython code that runs on both cores of your Raspberry Pi Pico or ESP32 like I've got here? And you want to know about threads and how they work? Then this is the show for you. So let's dive straight in. My name's Kevin. Come with me as we build robots, bring them to life with code, and have a whole load of fun along the way. Okay, let's get over to the keynote. Okay. So Dale's saying it's very timely this because he's just got an Arduino Potentia H7 with some Vision LoRa shields as well. Awesome. So yes, let's have a look what this is all about. So the session goals for today is let's learn how to use both cores on our Raspberry Pi Pico and ESP32. And there are slight differences between the two that we'll get into as well. We'll have a look at threads, what they are, multi-threading, the Diner's Philosopher's Problem, which is a cool computer science thought experiment that we will look at today, how to solve that problem using threads in MicroPython, and we'll have a demo on some real hardware with some of that code as well. Okay, so what is a thread? So in computer science, when a computer executes a simple program, it typically has a list of instructions and the computer works its way through that until the program is complete. And that single flow of code is called a thread. So typically with a thread, you have something called a stack. If you create a variable, that gets put on the stack. When you create a function and that function gets called, that gets put on the stack, and it's kind of like a stack of plates, if you like. So whatever you put on top is the thing that you have to take off to get things further down. We have a whole load of registers. We know about those, sort of setting values inside here, and we've got the code itself. So with a thread, it has access to all those things, and we don't have to worry about any kind of synchronization between things. Things just work. So with multi-threaded components, so a computer or microcontroller, these are microcontrollers rather than the Raspberry Pi, which is a full computer. Both of they can have multiple cores on them, meaning they've got two processors essentially inside them that have a shared amount of RAM, but they can run simultaneous pieces of code at the same time. And this is known as multi-threading. So you can have two threads on a Raspberry Pi Pico or on an ESP32. And each core has its own set of registers, its own stack, so that it can run independently of the other one. But they have a shared set of code and a shared memory that they can both access at the same time. So that's something that we need to bear in mind if we're writing programs. And it's a lot easier than you would think to do this as well. So let's get into some of the complexities around doing this to begin with. So there's this famous problem in computer science. It's called the Dining Philosopher's Problem. So there's five hungry philosophers. We've got Ayn Rand, we have Confucius, Plato, we've got Descartes, and we have Mary Wollstonecraft as well. So a very interesting group of people. I would love to be in on that dinner party as well. So let's see what this problem is all about. So they're all sat around a big table. Right in the middle of this table, there is a big bowl of spaghetti. And they have a chopstick to their right and to their left. And philosophers spend their time between thinking and eating. So to be able to eat, they need two chopsticks. So there's a problem here because not everyone can eat at once. As we can see on there, there's only five chopsticks. There's five philosophers and they need two chopsticks each. So what's going to happen if they all try and eat at the same time? There's going to be a bit of a problem. So let's have a look at this. So a philosopher must check to see if the chopsticks are being used. They can then pick them up. And if they picked one up and they picked another up, they can then start freely eating until they're satisfied and they can put them back down again. So once they are free, they can start eating. Two philosophers cannot use the same chopsticks at the same time. That would just get a bit weird, wouldn't it? Quite frankly. So this can cause a problem. Two philosophers try and use the same chopstick at the same time, or if they're waiting for a chopstick, they have one in their right hand and they're waiting for their left hand one to become available. If all of the philosophers do that, we're going to have a deadlock. And it's known as a deadlock in computer science. That's not a situation that we want to happen, because essentially your code will stop running and won't actually run any further until one of those has been released. But if they're all waiting for it, that will never happen. So when resources are not available for others, that's also known as resource starvation. And that's not a situation that we want. So we want a really efficient way of checking to see is the chopstick available and then grabbing it and then being able to eat. And then once we've done it, we need to be able to put them back down so that the next person can eat as well. So another problem is that checking to see if the chopstick is free and then getting it And actually getting it, they're two separate operations in computers. So setting it and checking it, or checking it and setting it, two operations, and they take time to do. So by the time you've actually checked to see, is that chopstick free? Yes, it is. You go to sort of get it. It might already have been got by the other philosopher in the in our scenario here. So that's a problem. So what that leads to is called a race condition. So we need to make sure that we don't get deadlocks and we don't get these race conditions where people are racing for the chopstick and somebody else has already got it. And then our program crashes because it checked to see was it available. And then when it went to get it, it wasn't available. So we don't want that kind of thing happening either. Again, there'll be some kind of awkward hand-on-hand situation that we might not want to happen. So we'll get into the solution to this shortly. So if you like what I do and you want me to make more of these videos, remember you need to like on this video, whether you're watching on Facebook or YouTube. Comment on the video, let me know what you think about this, whether you're going to use or whether you have any dual core ESP32s or Raspberry Pi Picos, and whether you use MicroPython or not. And also subscribe and hit that little bell notification button so that you know when a new video goes live. And I do a new live stream every single Sunday, 7 o'clock GMT. So if you want to follow me on social media, I think Alex is just putting a link in there in the chat, if you're on the live chat as you're watching this. You can also go to smartsfan.com/about/link_in_bio, and all the links to my social medias are there. So I'm on Twitter, Facebook, on YouTube, on World Wide Web at smartsfan.com. There's a mailing list as well that you can join if you want to get weekly newsletters and information about and hot tips about things all to do with robotics. You don't want to miss that. And I'm also on Instagram as well, so you can get those links there if you're interested in that. Okay, so let's just have a step back from this strange problem that we've been talking about. So the philosophers in our analogy are like threads on a computer. So each has got its own code sequence and a state. So they're either thinking or eating, they're processing something, or they're waiting for some resource to become free. Chopsticks are like shared resources such as memory, I/O devices, variables, files, etc. Anything that could be used by another process on the same computer. And deadlock, race conditions, and synchronization are all problems that we need to solve if we want multi-threading programs to just work. Now, this could be pushed down to the operating system level. This isn't something maybe we'd need to worry about, but with MicroPython, there isn't an operating system. So we need to make sure when we write our programs, they are thread safe, they work well. And Damien, who wrote MicroPython, has done a fantastic job of making sure your MicroPython device won't crash if you break any of these rules. You'll just get weird results if you try and access, say, the same variable at the same time. So the solution to all this is called mutexes. You might also hear them called semaphores. Semaphores are kind of a more granular, complex version of a mutex. A mutex is, you know, essentially a flag, yes or no, true or false. So a mutex stands for mutually exclusive. And a mutually exclusive lock or flag is a primitive which is used within multiprocessing. So we can use a mutex to ensure our resources can be accessed only by one thread at a time. And we use mutexes to protect sections of our code. We call these critical sections, preventing other threads from running until that protected section of code is executed. So it does kind of make, if there is another piece of code waiting to access, say, a critical resource, we can grab that resource, we can lock it before we grab it, we can do what we want, and then we release it. So mutexes are provided by the operating system, or in the case of MicroPython, by the interpreter itself. So multi-core processors and shared memory. So writing MicroPython code that uses both cores can lead to deadlocks and race conditions if we don't allow for it. So both the Raspberry Pi Pico and the expressive ESP32, which I have just here, both of these have dual cores. They are not exactly the same, and we'll get into some of the details any second. And they both have thread support through MicroPython. So if you're using MicroPython, I think version 14 and up, I think version 17 is the most recent version as the writing of this, if you like, 1.17, I think it is, they both support threads. The documentation for thread support is quite threadbare at the moment. I'm not going to say pardon pun. Puns are all part of the show. There isn't a lot of information about this. There isn't actually a lot of videos about this either. So I thought this would be quite useful for people who want to write code that can run simultaneously on both cores. And we'll have a look at that in the demo. So yes, one of the differences between the two of these is the Raspberry Pi Pico only supports two threads, one thread per core. I'm not sure why that is, but that's That's the limitation as we speak. Whereas the ESP32, you can run quite a number of threads on this. So more than one thread per core. And we'll actually experiment with that shortly and see just how many threads we can run on this. It's not as many as you'd think, but it's more than the Raspberry Pi Pico. So creating your first thread. You already know how to do this. If you just write a simple MicroPython program, you're already writing a single-threaded program. You don't need to worry about anything. Everything just works. So to create a program with two threads, we just use this underscore thread library. So to start a new thread, we use underscore thread dot start underscore new underscore thread. And then in the brackets, we put the name of a function that we want to run on the other core. And it's as simple as that. We'll have quite a few demos to go through and have a look at how we can use this, but it is as simple as that. So if we wanted to, for example, if I've got my little rangefinder here and I want to be able to take readings from this, I could run that piece on one core and I could have another piece of code running on another core, which is controlling, say, Bluetooth and the motors of our robot. And we can just grab the current value from the rangefinder without having to actually send the signal to get the distance. We can just have that running on a separate core. So it's really quite a cool thing to be able to do. And it's as simple as just defining a function and then running that function within this new start new thread. So it's as simple as that. So we just need to import underscore thread into our MicroPython code, define a function, and then call the start new thread. So we'll have a play with that shortly. And again, a note, remember the Pico has only got two cores. So core 0 is what your normal code runs on, and core 1 is the second core that's not normally used when you write a program. So as it says there, you can run about 16 threads on the dual core ESP32. I've got the ESP32S, I think it says on there. So that's the version I've been experimenting with. And this is just a regular Raspberry Pi Pico. So as the recording of this is like the 2020 version 1, if you like, of Raspberry Pi Pico. I'm sure they'll come out with new versions of that in the future. Okay, so you might get this error message if you try and run more than two threads on a Raspberry Pi Pico. It'll say OS error, core 1 in use. And that's because whenever you call that function to start a new thread, it essentially just creates that on the second core. If you run that twice, you'll get this message. So it just means you need to change your code to either only run when... And we'll get into how you can check if you've got more than one thing running at once. But essentially, you need to check is something already using that second core. We can do that with a variable. Threads automatically exit once their function returns. So if we created a function that grabs, say, the range, and we don't have that in a kind of while forever, while true loop. If that calls, when it's finished its stuff, it then frees up that core to be used again by another piece of code. So depending on how you write your code, you could perhaps use that. So at MicroPython threads, these are the four commands that we need to know about. And these are the only four commands that you can use in MicroPython for threads. It's very, very simple. It's not actually supported technically yet. The documentation, if you go to micropython.org, basically just says this is highly experimental and we haven't documented it yet. But it works very reliably, so it's not a problem. So yes, thread.allocate lock, that creates a lock. We'll have a look at what locks are for in a minute. We have acquire and release. They're to do with getting the lock and then releasing the lock. And then we have exit, which allows you to exit a thread. Threads will automatically exit once they've completed. But if we had something within a while loop and we wanted to be able to terminate that thread, we could use the thread.exit as well. Otherwise, it'll just carry on running forever. So we've got a simple program that we're going to write, which is the DAS blinking lights program. It's always like one of the first programs that people learn to write on, say, the Arduino or on a Pico. And we have some built-in LEDs on both of these boards. So on the Raspberry Pi Pico, the LED that's built on board, that's just around about here on the top, that's actually pin 25. On the ESP32, it's pin number 2. So we just need to remember that in our code, depending on which of the boards that we're actually using. So we're going to have two threads. One thread is going to turn on the LED and the other thread is going to turn off the LED. And we need some way of communicating between the two threads so that they don't overlap and don't kill each other. So without a lock, this is a weird behavior that we're going to get. And we can demonstrate this in a minute. So the LED flickers for maybe 1/100 of a second and then goes off. And we want it to stay on for a second and then go off. So on our thread number 1, our main program, we are going to have a variable that's called toggle, which is a boolean true or false. We're going to set it to false as we create it, and then we're going to say if it equals true, then we want to turn the LED on, otherwise we want it to sleep for a second. And on our second thread, we're going to say if the toggle is true, then we're going to turn the LED off and set the toggle to false, and then we're going to sleep. So we're going to, each of these is going to be cycling around its own little loop, independent of the other one. It's a bit like the whole patting your head and rubbing your stomach thing. You don't know where and when these things have started and where they are in their sequence. So it might be that the LED on and LED off are not a second apart, and therefore you get this little flash. Or it might be that they are both stretched as far apart as possible, so you do get almost a second's worth because we've got that sleep value. But there's no guarantee of that. So we need some way of locking the behavior, of changing that toggle, so that we can make sure our code executes properly. So that's without a lock. So with a lock, this is what the behavior looks like. It looks a bit more complicated as a flow, and it might take a second or two for you to understand this, but let's have a look through. So we're gonna use a lock. We're gonna use a mutex to lock our code in between the two threads. So this means that when a thread, this means the thread has to wait until the lock is free before it can acquire it for its own use, do whatever it needs to do, and then release it. So both of these two pieces of code have their own critical section where we need to be able to lock the behavior of the other thread so that we can continue and do our piece of work and then release it. So in these blue bits here, we've got acquire the lock. So to begin with, toggle is false. The lock is not acquired, so it's going to be acquired, which means thread one is locked. It has the lock enabled. So thread two is going to try and acquire the lock, but it can't because that's locked. So thread one can then come down and say, right, toggle equals true. So toggle becomes equal to true. It's going to turn on the LED. It's going to sleep for a second, and then it's going to go, it's going to release that lock, and then it's going to go back to the beginning and then try and acquire the lock again. So let's have a look what happens over in thread number two. This is going to try acquire the lock. It can't because that critical section is being executed. Only when the lock becomes free can it go, oh, great, I've got the lock now. It can then, and remember, toggle is true. It can say if the toggle is true, which it is, it's going to turn the LED off. It's then going to toggle. Toggle is going to become equal to false. It's going to toggle the toggle. So toggle is equal to false. It's then going to sleep for a second. After it sleeps for a second, it will release the lock, and then the lock is then free. And then whoever grabs it first is going to be able to execute their piece of code. Because this one has said locked acquire, that's probably the next one in the queue. And they'll keep going around like that. So one piece will execute, then the next, then the next, then the next. So it looks a little bit complicated, but this is kind of where we're up to. Hello, Sophia, how are you doing? So MicroPython that has a scheduler built in. So the threads execute for about 10 milliseconds and then they switch. Now on a Raspberry Pi Pico, this doesn't really mean very much to us because both of the threads can run at the same time on both cores. Whereas on the ESP32, because it can run more than one thread, each of those threads needs to get a slice of time to execute, and then it'll get swapped out for another thread that gets to execute for another 10 milliseconds, then it'll swap out another one and so on. And it'll do that on both cores. And it's whichever hasn't had the most amount of time. I don't think there's any kind of prioritization on there. It's quite a straightforward scheduler. So as it says there, on the expressive ESP32, we can have more than one thread per core. MicroPython switches between these multiple threads on the same core every 10 milliseconds, and the switching is invisible to the thread code. It just happens, your code just seems to run. On the Raspberry Pi Pico, it doesn't really switch, each core executes its own thread, but in the future, it might be that they make this a bit more complicated and allow you to run multiple threads. Again, I'm not sure why they've done that. There is a little overhead when you're doing threaded code because you do need to have that stack, you need to have that extra bit of memory available to store all of the local variables for that piece of code, and it needs to be able to sort of have them swap out when you have another thread running, so each thread needs its own little extra bit of memory. So that's probably why they've done that. I think the ESP32 has a tiny bit more memory than the Raspberry Pi Pico, if I remember correctly. Okay, let's get into a demo and have a play around with this. So I'm going to use Thonny. So let me just bring up Thonny. And what I will do, let me just move my windows around a second and then I share my screen. Okay, so I've got Thonny open here and I've got a number of different programs that I'm going to take you through. So the first one is just creating a simple thread. So let's go here. So we're going to import thread from the MicroPython library. It's available on all devices, so it's not something we have to download. It's already there. We can then type out hello, define hello as a function. We can then print hello world, and then we can say thread underscore thread dot start underscore new underscore thread, and then the name of that function. Now notice we don't have the brackets after that, but we do have them after that comma. So any arguments, any variables that we wanted to pass into there, we would put them in this second area here. So that's just something we need to look at if we're passing any extra variables to that particular thing. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm just going to make sure I've got, if I go to this shot here, we have this ESP32. You can see it's got a little red light on it there, so it's powered up. We'll have a look what's in this box shortly. And I've got a Raspberry Pi Pico just in, I've actually got two of them there. Just got Raspberry Pi Pico there, so we can try the same code on that one as well. So here's our ESP32. I'm just gonna move my window down here so we can see both things at the same time. I'm just gonna stop this code from running. I'm gonna check I've got ESP32 loaded down there. Make this window a little bit bigger and maybe make that one a bit smaller. So you can see that I've got 1.17. That's the version of MicroPython. And I'm just going to run this code. So if I just go up here, click on run. So it says hello world. And you can see that it's not actually, it's not exiting back to the interpreter. It's just running that on a separate thread. And it doesn't actually do anything else other than that. So there we go. So if I just do a equals one, let's see what happens there. It's just ignoring any input from the command line. So I'm just going to stop that for now. And then stop again. I think this is why they said it's a bit experimental. It seems a bit glitchy, the behavior, and it's because if you're running something on the separate thread, the REPL, the read, evaluate, print, loop command line is running on the first core. So things can run in the second core. Now you need to be able to use Control and D to be able to do a soft reboot like that, to be able to sort of clear anything that's running, any other threads that are running there. So that's a nice simple program. That's how we create a thread. So again, just have a quick look through that. We say import underscore thread. We do a function, def hello, and then that just prints hello world. And then we start a new thread. Now, if we have another thread, if we just have another piece of code underneath this that just says this is core one or core zero, and we change that from hello world to say this is core two, or this is core one. So zero and one, remember we're starting at zero in computing for some reason. Okay, if we run that now, we can say that says this is core zero, this is core one. So core zero interestingly ran first because it takes a little bit of time to spin up that second thread. And then the second thread ran. So this is what I mean about the synchronization. Sometimes things don't run in the sequence that you expect them to. Now, what we could do, if I have this line again underneath it, and I run that, let's see what happens now. So let's just try that one more time, run. So it says, this is core zero, this is core one, this is core one. So it actually ran three threads there. We had the thread running on the first core, and there were two threads running. We don't even know if they're on the first or second core. We just know that we actually had three threads running simultaneously at the same time. And interestingly, again, it was the last line that ran first because it was taking a bit of time for these two to spin up. We could do some timing. We could put in there some, get the current number of milliseconds and so on, just to see how long these things take to spin up. So that's how we create a thread. Let's do something a bit more interesting now. So we're going to run Das Blinking Lights. So let me go back to the full screen for a second. Let's just grab this and make this a bit bigger so that we can see what's going on. So a bit more involved this one. What we're going to do is we're going to import thread like we've done before. We're also going to import sleep from the time library and pin from the machine library. These work both the same on the Raspberry Pi Pico or the ESP32. On the ESP32, we need to be using pin number 2 for our built-in LED. So I'm just going to comment out that one there because that's the one on the ESP32. And then we've got a couple of different functions. So we have blink LED. So this is simply going to blink the LED value from 0, sleep for a second, and then set it to 1 and sleep for a second. That's all that piece of code does. And then we have another function that's called blink forever. And this says while true, blink LED. So it's basically just going to keep running that piece of code over and over and over again. And what we're going to do is we're going to start a new thread that runs that blink LED forever. And then at the same time, we're going to have another piece of code that says while true, print hello world, and then sleep for 2 seconds just to make it a bit more interesting. So let's go back over to this view here. Again, I'll just bring that window down so we can see kind of what's going on. And then I'm just going to give that a refresh on there. And then I'm going to run the script again. Okay. So it says hello world, and I don't know if you can see there, there's a little blue LED, and that's blinking on and off every second. And hello world is writing to the command line every 2 seconds. And those pieces of code are running completely independent of each other on separate cores. So that's what it looks like on the ESP32. So if I just stop that a second, let's try running that on the Raspberry Pi Pico. So if I come over down here to the interpreter selection, and instead of it being ESP32, I'm just going to unplug that one and plug in our Raspberry Pi Pico, and I'm going to select the Raspberry Pi Pico. It'll complain that you've just changed things over. There you can see it's got Micropython on the Raspberry Pi Pico. So we're just going to hit that stop button just to get it to refresh the REPL. And it should start to work. And there we go. So I can see that we've got all the different files on there. It's complaining still about the... So if we get this message, it's probably because I've got... I thought so. I've got Visual Studio running on a different machine, on a different window. So I'm just going to quit that and then go back on here. That's why that was complaining. I've got a plugin for Visual Studio. And that was stealing the command prompt. There we go. So I've got the MicroPython, again, version 1.17 on the Raspberry Pi Pico this time. What we need to do is just change that pin number. So instead of it being pin number 2, we're going to have pin number 25 instead. So let's just comment out that. And then let's run this code and see what happens. So you can see there's a little LED that's just flashing just there. And maybe we can zoom in a bit on these. Let me just zoom in a bit more. And I'll just move this kind of into position there so you can see the LED just there, which is flashing. So the same code works on ESP32 or the Raspberry Pi Pico. Okay, let's just unplug that, plug our ESP32 back in. And then I'll just go back down over here and change that to ESP32 again. Right, so that was a very simple blinking LED program. We'll come to a much more complicated version of that with a bit of inter-process communication between the two threads. But before we do that, let's see how many threads we can actually run at the same time. So again, let's go full screen on here. Let's go back to here so we can see the full thing. And let's have a look at this code. So again, we're importing the thread library. I'm going to create a new type of variable in this one. I'm not actually sure why I've done this one, but I'll explain that in a second. So I've created a variable that's called moo, just for mutex, and that's going to be of type allocate lock. So it's going to be a lock. So essentially, it's like a Boolean variable that's either locked or not locked, but it isn't true or false. It's either locked or not locked. We're going to have a variable that's called n that we're going to set to be 0. And then we're going to have a function that's called hello. And hello brings in that n. If we don't have the keyword global, that n will be local to that function and therefore won't change. Any value that's changed to that won't be set back in the main program. It's just a weird quirk of how Python does variables and global variables. And you're not generally supposed to use global variables, but this is a small program, so that's fine. So the first thing we're going to do with moo is we're going to acquire that lock. Remember when we had that sequence diagram and we needed to acquire the lock? That means that we've now, once that is set to true, and we'll wait until that lock is available, we can then execute this block of code until we release the lock. So we're going to say n equals to n plus 1, and we could just do n plus equals 1, but I just made that a bit easier to read there. We're then going to print hello world dash and then whatever the value of n is. And then we're going to release that lock and then we're going to exit that thread. We don't technically need that on there, to be honest. I think Damien said in one of the videos about MicroPython, it has a context manager, so if anything's left hanging, it will clean it up as it exits. So once that function is exited, it will exit the thread anyway. And then what we're going to do, we're going to say for I equals range. Now let's just do, let's start off with say 5. We're going to do thread new start, and we're going to say that hello function, we're going to just pass that. We're also going to print the word done. So if this works the same way that the other ones did, it'll print the word done first, and then it will print the hello world, and then however many times we run this. So let's now go to the run button. So some of the strange things have happened here. Let's have a look what's going on. We've got some weird, quirky error messages. Let's scroll to the top of this and let's see what is going on. So we should see, yeah, the word done appears, and then it says problem with Thonny's backend. And this is to do with the command line trying to write things and read things, and us using threads at the same time. Thonny's not really friendly with threads, so we get all these kind of weird error messages. However, we can see that it says hello world 1, 2, 3, and 4. And that's because of the way that range works. It's always like one number less than the range you specify. It's kind of up to 5, but not 5. So if we wanted to change that to say 6 and run that, we will see hello world 5 times. So it's kind of n minus 1. So that seems to work fine. We can have 5 threads running there. Let's try 10 and run that. So yeah, we're getting up to 9 there. So let's try 20, see what happens now. 20 threads, we get up to 17 and then it stops. So 17 seems to be the most number of threads that you can actually run on an ESP32. That might be because of a limitation. Remember the heap, the stack that it keeps, it has to have for each thread and then be able to swap them around. There must be a certain amount of RAM. We're hardly using anything here. We're just taking that variable n and changing it and then releasing all that. We're not really storing anything. So it might just be a limitation of that, or it might just be that's how many threads we can have on an ESP32. But it's more than enough for probably what we need when we're doing robotics. So let's just stop that for a second. And let us, I'll just do stop one more time. There we go. And you can always do Control and D if you just want to do a soft reboot. Okay, so that is lots of threads, so about 17 threads we had running there. Now the next program we're going to run is this inter-thread communication one. So this is where we have those two, it's the example we looked at before on the slides. We've got a function that sets the LED to be on and a function that sets the LED to be off, and they don't know about each other. That's all those functions do. So we're going to import thread, we're going to import pin from machine, we're going to import sleep from time, and then we're going to set a variable called LED on pin number, and on this example it's going to be pin number 2. If we wanted that to be on the Raspberry Pi Pico, we'd use pin 25. And then we set a variable that's called toggle to false. So I've commented out on the very first example of this, anything that has any kind of locking, so anything that does locking, acquiring, or releasing have all been commented out. This is the without locks version. So let's have a see what happens when we do that. So function led on just turns the LED to be value 1, which is on. We have led off, which is value 0. And then we say function switch off. So it brings in that global variable toggle, which is Boolean on or off, true or false. And then while true, so it's going to run this forever. If toggle is true, and we don't even have to put in the is true bit, it knows if toggle means if it's true, then turn the LED off and then set the toggle to be false. And then sleep for a second. And then go and do that again. Keep doing that. So that piece of code just keeps switching off the LED if it's true, if the toggle is on, which means the LED is on. We're then going to start a new thread using the underscore thread start new thread, and we're going to run that switch off on the second core. We're then going to say while true, toggle equals true, the LED equals on, and then sleep for a second. And again, keep running this. So one core is going to keep switching the LED on, the other core is going to keep switching the LED off, and the only thing that they got to see between them whether the LED should be on or off is that toggle, which is either true or false. Now remember what we said before we have the locking code, before we start uncommenting all this. What tends to happen is the LED will flick on for a fraction of a second and then go off immediately, because it isn't blocking the code to run its sleep properly. It's just instantaneously seeing that variable has changed and then turning the LED off. So let's try running this. Let's go back over to our example there. Now you might just be able to see there the LED is just flicking on just for a second. It's just that LED just there. I don't know if you can see that, but it's flicking on just for a fraction of a second. It's very difficult to actually see it because it's happening so quickly. So you might just be able to see a blue flicker every now and again. There you go. Flick, flick, flick. But it's not staying on for a second. It's just probably a hundredth of a second. It's barely enough time for it to power that LED. So let's go back to the code and let's uncomment all the acquire and releases. So the first thing we're going to uncomment is the lock itself. So we're going to create a new variable called lock, and that's of type thread.allocate lock. We're then going to come down to our switching off function. And before we do the critical part, which is changing the value of that variable toggle, we are going to lock it and then we're going to release it. So we're going to acquire the lock, which means only run this code once the lock is free. We're then going to do our toggle. If toggle LED is off and then toggle equals off, then sleep for a second, then release the lock. So down in our main piece of code, we can do the same thing. We can acquire that lock. So once that's been released, we can then run this piece to toggle becomes equal to true, set the LED on, wait for a second, and then release our code. So let's run this and see what happens. So I go back over to here, and let's just run that again. I think it just sometimes it does that. So you can now see that that blue LED is staying on for an entire second and then going off for an entire second. Now, the more astute amongst you might think, well, why don't you just refactor your code so you've got the sleep at the very beginning of your code rather than at the end? So in the switch one, if we put that sleep code at the very beginning, we probably wouldn't need to do the acquire and release. But I just wanted to show you what happens when you have those in there. It means it stops one call from doing something while the other one does something. And therefore, you've got a form of synchronization between the two because it's only allowed to continue on the other one when the first one has finished doing what it needs to do. But it's very reliable at doing that. We could use this. This is the exact same problem that happened to me many times. I wrote a program, a Bluetooth program for the SMARS robot that meant you could have a little remote control and when you press forward, the robot would move forward. And I didn't use the serial.any command, which means if there's any data in the buffer, then, you know, take the code from that buffer and, you know, make a decision what you're going to do backwards, forwards, left or right. And because I wasn't using that any function in the serial.any, it meant that I was just grabbing the data probably before it was even written properly to the buffer. So I was getting half written data. And that's the exact same thing that's happening here, where the LED flicks on for a second and then goes off. We're not really waiting and allowing our critical code to execute properly. So I hope that explains it, how to use both cores on both of your Raspberry Pi or ESP32. And I can show you that that code runs just the same on the Raspberry Pi Pico. So let's just plug that in. So I've got that there. So I just need to change the value of, let's go back over to here for a second, that pin, so that needs to be pin 25, because that's the value of the GPIO pin for Raspberry Pi Pico for the built-in LED. And I just need to go down here and change that to be a Pico as well. Probably get that message. Nope, it's happy there. And then we can run this code and then let's go back over to here. So you can see now the LED is flicking on and off for a second. Let's put that a bit close to the camera so you can see it. So it's nicely flicking on and off, which means both cores are communicating via that variable toggle. And we're protecting the variable toggle, even though it's just a true or false and it's probably just a single bit being flipped. We're protecting that whole critical block of code on each of the threads to make sure that they do what they need to do before the other one can switch it off, switch it back on. Okay, so I'm just going to go back over here for a second. I'm just going to stop that from running on there as well. And I think that's all the code that I wanted to share with you today. I've shown you running on both the Raspberry Pi Pico and the ESP32. Remember, the Pico can only have two threads, one on each core. The ESP32 can have up to 17, it seems, split between the two cores. Okay, so let's have a look at some of the other things going on today. Before I go to the comments, I want to show you some other things, and then we'll end the show for people who are not watching this live, but we'll carry on our live stuff as well. So over here, let me just zoom out for a second. I have a box, and in this box is something I've been waiting for a little while, and it's the Uno Mini. This is a limited edition thing that Arduino did. They've sold over 1 million devices worldwide, and to celebrate that, they released this special edition Arduino Mini. So let's have a look inside the box, and you get a specific number as well. So if I open this up, you can see there, I've got number 942, and it's signed by, well, it's kind of a printed version. It says, a little jewel as a big thank you for all the loyal support over the years. You are our inspiration, and we've got names of the people there from the Arduino team. And there's the serial number of the one I got. And then there is the tiny, tiny little Arduino Mini. So this thing is absolutely minute. I think it's an AT Tiny that's in there. 80 mega tiny, and it's got these protectors on there as well, just for the header pins. And this thing is absolutely minute. So let's just have a closer look at that. So it's got USB-C on there. It has the reset button. It's got some tiny headers. I don't think we can see very well there the writing on the chips. But the actual Atmel chip, I think it's that one just there. You can just see the Atmel logo on it. So on the back, there's not very much going on there, but it's got some writing on there. So it says, Uno Mini, limited edition, open source is love, designed and assembled in Italy. So I've not actually run any code on this yet. I wasn't sure what I was going to do with this, but I might put it in a little frame or something like that, just to show support for the Arduino Uno. So it's quite a lot smaller. I'm going to put another chip next to it just so you can see just how small this thing is. So do we have a... Just looking around to see if I've got an Arduino to hand. I can certainly show you the Raspberry Pi Pico next to it. You can see there just how small this thing is. There's the ESP32 as well. Absolutely tiny. So it doesn't have any Wi-Fi, Bluetooth or anything like that. It's very much like the original 8-bit Arduino, just a much smaller version of it, but in this sort of very nice little presentation case. It's just a little thing that came with it. So I wanted to show you that. The other thing I wanted to show you was this that's just behind me here. So this is my Raspberry Pi cluster you can see running here. This is the prototype version of the clustered Pi. So I've got four nodes on that. Each of them has got four cores, I think, each. So I've got 16 cores there. So I built a little console to go with this. So this is a battery powered. You can see there it's running. It's got a couple of 18650s inside, and it's just got a Raspberry Pi Zero W in there. You can see it's got a bit of Wi-Fi, and designed the case all by myself in Fusion 360. It's based on an old retro Cray 1 console. I saw a photograph in the Cray 1 brochure of this lady using a console that looks almost exactly like this, but they had the 3x4 rather than the 16x9 aspect ratio, so this looks a little bit wider, but it sits nicely on there, and just means I can connect to that particular console and see what the cluster is up to. So I just wanted to share that with you. If you're interested in that, I can share the STL files and maybe do a little video on it as well. Cool, so let's get over to the live chat, shall we? So if you're watching this on the replay, if you're watching this on YouTube, this is the point of the show where I'll say thank you for watching. Bye for now.